The CanAsian Arts Network recognizes and pays respects to the original people of this land. For time immemorial, Indigenous peoples have cared for and stewarded the lands known to many as Canada so that each of us today can benefit from all the gifts the land provides. Out of respect for the rights of Indigenous peoples, it is our collective responsibility to critically interrogate colonial histories and their present-day implications. We therefore work from the perspective of honoring, protecting, and sustaining the land and the people who were first on this territory to move beyond acknowledgement and into the doing. Similarly, we recognize the impact of colonial history and structures on our own communities and of those of other people of color. We extend a hand in partnership to those who wish to move beyond allyship to become an accomplice in dismantling them. My name is Sean C. I'm a father, artist, and community organizer based in Amiskwichi Waskaikin, known as Edmonton, Treaty 6 Territory, and Métis Homeland. Through funding support from Canada Council for the Arts and administrative support from Festival Access Asie, the CanAsian Arts Network has created digital content to guide, mentor, inform, and educate equity-seeking artists, cultural workers, organizations, and festivals in Canada. This series of digital literacy workshops will cover a variety of topics on business administration and legal considerations, introduction to social media and digital marketing, and encourage ways to decolonize in the digital space. These workshops will be followed up by a series of community conversations and roundtable discussions with arts leaders to help us all learn from each other. Make sure to sign up at canasianarts.com to get links to all the online content. For this workshop, we've invited Jen Sungshine and David Ng to share their story about navigating collective structures from the ground up. Welcome, David and Jen.
Hi.
Hi, thanks, Sean. David and I are so excited to be here. Should I start the slides? What makes
yeah.
sense? Okay, yeah, I'll start the slides. We're pros at this.
Maybe while Jen is pulling up the slides, I'll just mention that Jen and I are giving this presentation from the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations, also known as Vancouver.
Great. My name is Jen Sungshine, and I'm here with my dear friend and longtime creative partner, David Ng. We want to begin this workshop, this presentation on navigating collective structures from the ground up, not from a place of expertise, but from a place of relationships and experiences and story. So we'll be sharing our experiences and our stories in founding love intersections, but also other collective structures like not-for-profits, co-ops, sole proprietorships, et cetera, et cetera. And all of it is kind of rooted in this idea that relationships should be centered.
Yeah. And, you know, we'll touch on upon this more in a moment, but part of why Jen and I started Love Intersections, why we started pursuing making art together was really to do anti-racism through the arts. And so when we started thinking about how do we do that work, one of the things that has come up for us time and time again in our workshops, in the projects that we do, is how do we enact social justice values in our work? And so how we sort of structured this workshop today is thinking about, you know, this mandate of ours and how do we do anti-racism work through the arts? How do these notions of accountability also show up in these different entities that we've had to navigate and these other types of collective structures that we have formed?
Mm-hmm. So maybe we'll share a little bit about Love Intersections and a little bit about ourselves. In 2013, 2014, we founded Love Intersections,
oh,
but in 2013, The joke is that the origin story of David and I is that I picked up David at the Vancouver Public Library while he was tabling for an organization that he was working with at the time. And I knew right away that we would go on to, well, that we were meant to create something together. So at the time, I was sitting on the Vancouver School Board's Pride Advisory Committee, and we were part of this program called Out in Schools, and we had a seat at the table, so to speak. And we were updating a 10-year-old policy to make schools safer for transgender students. And David and I, when we talk about the origin story of love intersections, we're very deliberate, intentional, but also careful in naming who it was that was protesting this policy update. And they were primarily Chinese evangelical conservative Christian parents. So hundreds of people signed up to speak for or against this policy update. What we noticed was that the experience, there were a couple of things. One, there was a tremendous language barrier with the parents that were protesting, and then our side that were in support of this policy. And we actually observed that there was quite a lot of racism in the queer community because of the ways in which the predominantly white media was reporting on this quote unquote controversy. David, did you want to kind of share a little bit about that from your end?
Yeah, and so, you know, this is a community. So the protesters were a community that I'm really familiar with because I also grew up in a fundamentalist Christian home. And part of what Jen is alluding to was we felt, you know, there were many layers that where Jen and I felt erased, essentially. So as Jen mentioned, a lot of the media representations were really quick to talk about. There was literally headlines that said, ethnic Chinese protest LGBT policies again. Mm-hmm. And one of our frustrations was, you know, I think it was Abbotsford, about 4 months
Langley
prior.
Langley
and Abbotsford, 4 months prior, a group of white Christians protested a very similar policy, but of course they never named, you know, white Anglo-Saxon fundamentalist Christians, that never happens that way. And so that was one of the frustrations. And so Jen and I, and then as Jen mentioned, you know, we started hearing also some racist comments from the queer community, our supporters, who were saying things like, you know, what is wrong? What is it with your culture that is so homophobic. Or conservative? And so out of that frustration, you know, Jen and I wanted to share our stories because, you know, while my coming out, I'll speak personally, wasn't necessarily easy, it wasn't like this dire picture that the media often paints. And so we wanted to share our own stories. And so that was sort of how Love Intersections started. In making films, so I have a bit of a filmmaking background, in starting to make films about other people's stories, this sent Jen and I down a path of thinking about accountability and collaboration. What does that look like when we're sharing other people's stories? You know, how do we not, obviously, we wouldn't replicate the horrific, you know, media representations that we experience, but how do we do this work in a good way? And I want to just quickly connect this to what we opened this presentation with again, because we're going to get into decision-making and boards and nonprofits, is thinking about that type of accountability and those values of social justice that we were talking about in the beginning. How do those, so in starting Love Intersections, how do we create that foundation in our arts practice about accountability, but also how is that reflected in the ways that Jen and I are working together, basically? Yeah.
I wonder, David, should we talk a little bit about our board and creating this not-for-profit? And
yeah.
When did we decide that it was time for us to, you know, turn Love Intersections, which started just as, you know, just me and David, and turning that into an actual entity?
Yeah, I think, okay, I'm going to state the obvious, but, a lot of this conversation around this is going to be, how do we access money to do the anti-racist work that we want to do in the arts, right? But it really is, how do we access money? And so I think we'll start with the nonprofit society, but even before that, you know, I think thinking about what do we do when we start from nothing, right? I mean, for love, you know, and to be really specific, how do we build up our CV so that funders can start to look at our proposed projects and say, okay, these folks have done this, they want to do something similar, this project is feasible. Mm-hmm. And so really, I mean, Jen and I literally started pitching in $50 each, like literally $50 each, and getting a favor from our videographer friends. I have an editing background. We cobbled together, I think it was two or three films, really, really rough films, which in my, you know, as much as I'm kind of poo-pooing the quality, they are still being used in curriculum today, so which I'm very proud of. But, you know, it was really, and then Jen, if you want to share that next slide, actually. Yeah. So building up those couple films, or making those first few films, we got into a couple film festivals, and then it started building our CV. So for just to be also very specific, Canada Council views a film festival submission or a acceptance into a film festival as a curated artwork, which it is. And so that then allows us to build our CV in terms of what exhibited artwork we have. Mm-hmm. In terms of the nonprofit society, so that's the first one that we'll talk about. Really, a nonprofit society allows you to have a separate entity that is accountable because you have a board. It is, you know, you have to file taxes and whatnot. But it also allows you to separate some of the liability and also some of the accounting from your personal self. So, for example, if we receive like a $20,000, if I was doing a project and it was a $20,000 project, having it run through a nonprofit means that, you know, for tax reasons, it doesn't look like income in my, or, you know, it doesn't look like income that came into me unless I bill for it and I get paid for it through the nonprofit. So it's those sorts of more logistical things that a nonprofit can support. So this is how we also work with our board. There's many different types of boards. There are, but Love Intersections, we don't have a working board. We have a very hands-off board. The board is accountable and make sure that, you know, Jen and I are following the books and that, you know, we're doing things accordingly. But we deliberately formed a board that was, formed an organization that was staff run. And I modeled this a lot after my experience working for Theater for Living. Theater for Living was a grassroots theater company that did socially engaged theater work. And I modeled this after a lot of the learnings that I learned through David Diamond, just about, you know, there's nothing, and again, this isn't to say that one is worse than the other or one's better than the other, but one thing to keep in mind with how you form a nonprofit working board, hands-off board, staff run, there's many other types too, but these are the two that I know. Is the amount of work that it will take to make a decision. And so if you have a working board that, you know, that is volunteer, that's another thing to keep in mind. Boards members can't be compensated for legal reasons. That's something you have to keep in mind because if you have a working board that is volunteer, you have to, for these big decision-making things, they have to gather, they have to meet and discuss, debate, and make a decision. So those are sort of things to keep in mind.
Mm-hmm. We should be also clear that so David and myself are also have our own individual arts practice as well. And so we can talk more a little bit about that as well. So we both also have our own sole proprietorships that is connected to our own arts practice. And then we have Love Intersections in addition to a plethora of other entities that we'll be discussing and going over today. But and I'm jumping all over the place now, but even, you know, almost 9 years later, David and I are still not full-time at Love Intersections. It's not actually possible. So don't let that, you know, decide whether you want to start a not-for-profit society or not, because it takes time to really build up your repertoire, And it really takes time to also build the relationships, especially for Dave and I. We work so closely and deeply within communities, and relationships take time.
I should just mention one quick thing just about membership as well for nonprofits. Mm-hmm. Something to keep in mind is, this is another way that you can run a nonprofit too, is there are, you have to have members. Because a nonprofit has to have that level of community transparency. And so, you know, you have to think about, what does that look like? How are you going to get members so that you can elect a board, you know, and ensuring that you build that relationship in community, because there are situations where, you know, if you build an organization really big and people want to take it over, they can. So that's something to, you know, that, and this is an important way that it ensures an accountability with community as well. Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about money.
Yes.
backtrack one more, which is that we're not a we're a not-for-profit society, but we don't have charitable status. So that's the other thing too. When we started out, you know, almost 9 years ago, we should have started from there perhaps, but we didn't jump into creating a not-for-profit society, which also has its own paperwork and also takes time. I think it was like 3 or 4 years in that we actually got the society number. But at the very beginning, in order to, you know, have funds to work with, you know, like we said, $50 and then producing artwork and film work, we partnered up with, and there are other organizations that do similar initiatives like this. So we partnered up with an organization that had charitable status, that was able to house our little group of just me and David. And then they were able to kind of distribute some of the funding of the grants that we were getting. So there's other avenues of accessing that as well.
Yeah. Yeah. So in terms of grants, this was, we wanted to sort of share a couple of these grants, because then it'll kind of give you a picture as to the entities that are, that collective structures that we've been already talking about. So BC Arts Council and Canada Council are, you know, for artists probably, or I guess this is Canada wide, but the provincial arts councils and the Canada Council, the national arts councils, are probably the main place that we get our funding from. And as Jen mentioned, so we have our separate practices, which sometimes, you know, I will have my own art project. That's where, as Jen alluded to, sometimes we have set up a sole proprietorship. So a sole proprietorship is basically a business that you have, that allows you basically to have a business license to open a bank account, so that you can kind of separate out, okay, this is the money that is going to my arts practice, and this is, you know, so that it's not just going into your checking account.
Mm-hmm. Can I just interject, since we're talking about sole proprietorship? I'm jumping ahead slightly, David, is that sometimes, because Dave and I are working in film, so sometimes when we're accessing specifically film money, they often require a production company. And at the time, we obviously, Love Intersections is not a production company. So a sole proprietorship is also really, really useful in that sense, to then house the funds from these film grants. Tell a Story High, for example, is one of those, project initiatives.
So that was, we were talking about Canada Council and BC Arts Council. But as we, you know, as we mentioned, with Love Intersections work, we can also apply as a collective as well. And so that's another way that, you know, when we have a project that we want to do together, we can apply to BC Arts Council and Canada Council. There are some grants. So as Jen mentioned, the charitable status thing, funders over the past, you know, 9 years that Jen and I have been doing work, they've gotten much better, because many grants used to require charitable status, and most don't now. But places like, you know, Vancouver Foundation, some of their grants still require charitable status, and most of them will now even advertise the grants as you can have an intermediary. So that was what Jen was alluding to. Right. You can also partner with an intermediary to apply for those grants. One thing we also just wanted to mention as well, because as I imagine many of you watching this audience are, or many of you watching this workshop in the audience are likely artists of color. So especially with the political climate right now, a lot of funders have EDI and affirmative action quotas. Because we do, Jen and I, as we mentioned at the beginning, do anti-racist work in the arts, or use art to do anti-racist work, we're constantly bumping up against what the funders are the funders' mandates. And one of the things that I've encountered, and I personally believe this to be true, is that artists, especially artists of color, have always and continue to be five steps ahead of funders in terms of EDI and affirmative action. Those policies that they've implemented, I think, are really important for keeping white-led organizations accountable. But something to keep in mind is, what we've encountered is that they're doing. What actually happens on the ground in terms of anti-racist work from the arts is quite different from what the funders are asking for. And I'm going to give a very specific example. So last year, it's 2023 right now. In 2021, in the middle of the pandemic, the world, in many places in the world, we saw a really sharp rise in anti-Asian racism. And also with the Black Lives Matter movement in the States in 2020 and 2021, a lot of heightened conversations around racism. And there was a funder that we were connected to that had separate streams for anti-Indigenous, anti-Black, and anti-Asian racism. And one of the things that we brought up and pushed on is, in our work, in the projects that we were doing, how do we address these anti-Asian racism? Because obviously Jen and I are East Asian. How do we address the systemic issues of colonialism and anti-Black and anti-Indigenous racism that produce anti-Asian racism? How do we do things intersectionally? And so we eventually were able to do a project, I think, that did do this, but this is one of the examples of, I understand the intention of the funder, but when we look at this issues of systemic racism, oftentimes it doesn't really translate well in terms of the funders' mandates. Mm-hmm. So keep pushing.
and I do, and really want to kind of hone in on the pushing, because I think that it is so imperative that artists and artists of color interrogate grant funders and interrogate the systems at which we find ourselves in. And I think that we can play a very crucial part in, as slow as it may be, in enacting systems change. The more artists, push back on how these funds are administered or types of streams that they have to kind of, and the hoops that they have to jump through, the chances are higher for funders to, change the way that they have these grants out.
Yeah. It's important to note that even in this, I'm going to add one more thing just to talk about money again, because, we see this little, it's important to know that the pie that we have access to as artists of color is still teeny, 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 tiny compared to the much larger pie that is going still to white-led organizations. So I think it's really important, to continue pushing.
And I can't tell you how many times David and I have kicked ourselves in retrospect because we asked for too little. We asked for too little money, and we saw that there was this, nationwide mandate for whatever to distribute this funds, emergency funds, all of the COVID funds. And because whether it's because we're being conservative or we have imposter syndrome, we don't want to lie, we never ask for more. And yet that's actually exactly what you should be doing, because other organizations that are established have, full-time grant writers in their organizations are able to ask for much more because they have these people full-time.
Yeah. So. And we will get into some of these examples. I know Jen and I went on we're talking all really broad stuff right now as well, but we will get into some examples of how we've navigated some of this.
Yeah. We talked about this already.
Yeah. Should we go to the co-op stuff?
Co-op? Yeah.
Yeah, so we're going to also share a little bit about co-ops and unions. So Jen and I were co-founders of a Vancouver Artist Labor Union Cooperative and the Value Community Projects Society, as well as the Artists and Cultural Workers Union. And I'm talking about these three at the same time because, so one of the
and
things
the season
that...
means video co-op.
Yes, the season so means video co-op.
We do so much.
So we're talking about these three entities because going back to our mandate of social justice in the arts, one of the things that we were this problem that we and when I say we, it's just not just me and Jen. There were 16 artists that started Value Co-op and the Artists and Cultural Workers Union. One of the things that we wanted to address was the exploitation of artists and employment precarity for artists, and so. Value Co-op is a cooperative, a worker co-op. It's a for-profit business. And the idea behind Value Co-op was to provide flexible and living wage income to artists. I'll talk just really briefly about the co-op structure. And again, I'm not an expert. We've just started, we've started these two co-ops, but there are many, many, many different types of co-ops. Value Co-op is a worker co-op, so workers have a vote in and all make decisions together through a general assembly. Co-ops also have a board, technically, which holds the legal liability. So in terms of thinking about ending exploitation of artists and trying to be as democratic as possible and also flatten hierarchy and engage with power dynamics in Value Co-op, one of the things that we did was we transferred all of the decision-making from that normally is made by the board to the General Assembly.
What we didn't realize is, I wonder if this is what you're about to say, David, but one of the things that elicited this decision of transferring that power to the General Assembly was that we realized when we had mandated, because we are artists that do anti-racist work, when we mandated a 50% BIPOC representation on the board, we realized that in the pandemic, the 50% of the BIPOCs that's on the board is doing a lot of free labor.
That's a
and
good
all
point.
Of those, yeah. All of those tough emotional labor work was then an HR conflict resolution was all of a sudden thrown at the BIPOC board members. Yeah.
And I so want to connect this
that's
back
the big
to
the, irony the, of the day.
I want to connect this back to what we were just discussing, actually. So this is what happened. This is sort of some of the issues that are raised with some of these affirmative action policies as well that we were alluding to is when we want BIPOC leadership, what is the labor being asked of racialized people? So going back to Value Co-op, one of the things that we did, so we have the picture that, you can click that. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Jen. So the picture that is behind there is the studio. It's a benevolent association building in Chinatown. I have worked in that building for 23 years. And so I have a relationship with the LIM Association that owns the building. And they invited us to lease the space. And one of the things that we were really intentional about because of the role that artists have played in gentrifying Chinatown and Chinatowns all over Turtle Island is we really wanted to build reciprocal relationships in the community.
Again, and you'll note.
So go ahead. Yeah.
So I was going to just say, you'll notice that Dave and I talk about relationships a lot, and it is the kind of governing theme or philosophy or ethics, if you will, that informs everything that David and I do. So when we're talking about these relationships, as an example, David's relationship to this building, his relationship to the LIM elders, having worked in that building for over 20 years, it's not just about crediting those people mm-hmm. that brought us into, organizations or organizing or collaborations, but it's an honoring of the continuation of a deepening relationships that only serves the community and serves the neighborhood. And we, as artists, we have an ethical responsibility to do that. And so relationship yeah. is the number one motivation and the governing theme.
Yeah. Thank you, Jen. And
so I'll just kind of go here.
Yeah, and you know, and linked to that too is, you know, the overarching thing that we are navigating is, to be frank, is when we talk about money, is capitalism, right?
Yes.
And so how are we, when we're again navigating, you know, making art and accessing funding, going back to, you know, decision making and accountability again, how are we doing this in a good way? And how do those values that, you know, we want in our artwork, how do those also show up in the ways that we build these collective structures?
Yeah. It's not something that grant funders, it's very difficult to translate that in our grants. And so what David and I often come across, and it becomes sort of a barrier, is that because so much of our work is collaborative, it's very, very challenging to like translate that so that it's clear to the funders, what exactly are we doing? Because so much of our work is based on relationships, and based on relationships, it's process work. My background is in facilitation. And so I highly value the power of process and the power of, you know, group work, right? But that's not something that is something that funders can see very clearly.
And I want to give a specific example. So this quote that Jen has up there, relationships move at the speed of trust, but social change moves at the speed of relationships. This was a big learning for us because, you know, Jen and I both have women's studies degrees. We are in the world of social justice. And one of the things that we recognize through all of this, the 9 years that we've been doing this, is you can have understand and have all of the analysis, but unless you are moving in a relationship together, there's no foundation of trust to do that work. And this is from, I'm thinking about from the nonprofit stuff that we've been talking about, to the co-ops, to the, you know, to the other projects, community projects that we're going to share as well, is really the building that foundation of trust has been a critical part of doing the work, not just in a good way, but also ensuring that the work actually happens too.
Mm-hmm. And that's quite, you know, literally the from the ground up, right? And you'll notice that as time went on, the more David and I get into more projects and more groups and more structures and more collective entities, because I think going back to what David was talking about in terms of not just the relational responsibility to the Chinatown neighborhood in Vancouver, to the, you know, Chinese elders that are there, and to, you know, ostensibly our landlord, the Lim elders of that building, there is a responsibility that we put our efforts into as well through mutual aid. And so the Value Community Projects Not-for-Profit Society also funnels a lot of mutual aid projects. That also kind of goes back to the reciprocal relationship with Chinatown. And so I think
We're gonna end by sharing a couple of the work that we've done through Value Community Projects, just because it really illustrates all of these major themes that we've been talking about: the nonprofit, the co-op, building relationships and community. I'll just share the quick story about how that came about. So as I mentioned, you know, we were intentional about building reciprocal relationships. So when we moved into that space, we had a meeting with the elders. They invited us up for tea, and they mentioned, you know, in one conversation, you know, one of our colleagues, Emily, pointed to these beautiful old books that they had up there. And one of the elders said, you know, they're really old, we'd love to digitize them. And then another elder said, you know, we'd love to have, you know, this reminds me, we've always really wanted to have a website. And this really gave us this idea, you know, as artists, we're looking at archival work and the potential to do something creative. And so we accessed a BC Heritage grant to digitize their archives. And then from that, from the archives, now we had all this archival work that we had been doing, and we applied for arts funding to do an exhibit. We also did some oral history interviews with the elders, and this culminated into an exhibit that we just had in September called The House of Nine Dragons. So maybe we can just share a little bit about some of the case studies. In the beginning of the pandemic, there was a group of this, and we weren't directly involved with this group. We created a little documentary about their work. But these folks that had connections in Chinatown basically formed like a little grocery delivery service for Chinese speaking elders in the neighborhood, recognizing that, you know, there was having not just food, but also culturally appropriate food was difficult in the pandemic because, you know, especially elders who are vulnerable because of their age weren't, you know, this was a bit of a crisis. And so this was an emergency response program that was started in 2020.
Mm-hmm. And again, really deepening our relationship, our ethical relationship with the Chinatown neighborhood, as well as the organizations that are in Chinatown and do Chinatown work.
And this was, I will also just quickly mention, you know, one of the things that we want, it started off as Jen and I wanting to highlight the, you know, around this idea of anti-Asian racism, but also like the negligence from the government to address not just when we think of anti-Asian racism, we think of like the violence, which is obviously horrible. But this is also, I would argue, a type of, you know, pretty horrible too, right? Where, you know, and it's obviously not just Asian communities that face this, but, you know, other racialized communities where English isn't your dominant language, who are also facing these food insecurity issues that were heightened by the pandemic.
Yeah. So the front of our print shop is a space that we often apply for grant funding through these relationships, through these collaborations with different organizations and different groups in Chinatown, but also beyond, means that we have an opportunity to also give, you know, an installation space for artists and to profile artists who may otherwise not have visibility. And one of the things that we did, and community responsiveness is also part and parcel to how we do anti-racist work ethically and responsibly. And the way that we did that was by putting a spotlight on these emerging and up and coming artists and having their art installed, as you can see in the slide, you know, culturally appropriate artwork on the windows.
I forgot what I was going to say. I was going to say something about these. Oh, right. Yes. I should also mention, you know, going back to our earlier point around community collaboration, these windows were sponsored by the Downtown Eastside Heart of the City Festival. They reached out to us and were like, you know, we saw that you guys were doing this work at Chinatown. You know, you have this intention to do this type of work. And they basically were like, we just want to support you guys. And they funded the first few windows. So
that's right.
Not just to thank them, but obviously, but like, you know, this is another example of that type of relationship building that can happen.
The next kind of relationship case study is, of course, David had mentioned the exhibit. It was a multi-year project with the Limb Association elders. And here we are with this group. All of the weirdo artists are in the front row kneeling down, and all of the elders are in the back. And this is the actual building on the third floor, the Limb Association space. We did this exhibit with them and invited the public to learn more about the history of the building, which is a heritage building. The exhibit featured artworks and oral history interviews of the Lim elders and their lives. David also mentioned the ongoing relationship with the Downtown Eastside Heart of the City Festival. And this is also a totally new relationship in terms of our recent collaboration with Nadine Spence, who is an Indigenous artist in the middle there. And we helped to produce with her, the Elements Unite. So this is the window install, and this is the Elements Unite chess that she helped to create.
Yeah, and I'll just quickly mention, because we did talk about earlier that example of the anti-Indigenous, anti-Black, and anti-Asian racism. So this was actually part of our response to it. So we brought this idea to, or we had a conversation with Nadine, and Nadine shared a similar intention in terms of wanting to build intercultural solidarity in the neighborhood. And so this project that she invited us to be a part of is called Honoring Our Grandmother's Healing Journey. There's 14 cedar chests. That are 13 of them are painted by Indigenous artists. So the chests are going to contain stories from people in the downtown east side, their ancestor. And the 14th chest that she commissioned is the Elements Unite chest. It's called the Elements Unite because when we had lunch, we realized that in all of our different cultures, there's a culture around like the elements. In traditional Chinese medicine, in from Nadine's culture, in Indigenous culture as well. And so it's a collaboration between different artists of color that contributed to create this chest. Yeah.
And then here's the fun one. In terms of our, we had to pivot all of our programming during COVID. David and I joke that we went on a guilt tour of gathering money from grant funders who were, you know, specifically giving out money for Asian organizations that do, you know, anti-Asian violence work. In response to that, we produced the Hot Pot Talks. It's a live stream recorded sort of podcast, video podcast, where David and I interview artists, chefs, community organizers.
Including Sean.
Including Sean. Yes, that's right. To come on our show to talk about the very subject that we're talking about today and beyond. So a lot of it kind of is rooted in just, expanding our relationship to the community. Because really the sky is our limit. And yet we have to, and we were just talking about this at the beginning of the presentation, is that it is so necessary for us to cultivate relationship and a deep kind of relationship, which takes so much time and so much work, but it is so integral to a deepening of our own creative and artistic practices. It also then nourishes back into the community and it's translated through our artwork. So they go hand in hand.
Yeah, and I'll maybe just also add, you know, and we hope that from how Jen and I, when we were thinking about this presentation, is that, you know, and I know that we've bounced around, you know, our practice, collective structures, because really for us, and I imagine for many artists, you know, there's the separation between how we organize and our arts practice, you know, it oscillates a lot, or there's really no separation. Yeah. And so, I think, and I also, you know, it's not just about navigating the difficulties of, you know, these structures, but it's also, I think, you know, and I love how we ended with Hot Pot Talks, because it's also, I think, an opportunity for us to be creative about how we navigate those structures and also produce art and do things in a fun and also good way.
Yeah. And I think maybe this is something that I feel distinguishes us from kind of other mainstream organizations or not-for-profits, is because of our, because of how meaningful and how much focus we center on relationship, that relationship centeredness actually is very, very useful when we're dealing with conflict and conflict resolution and conflict in arts groups and arts organizations. There is a global reckoning, of call-outs and injustice. And yet David and I have really been able to depend so much on our existing relationships and new relationships that help with conflict. And that's something that, you know, is not taught in art school, right? Like, you gather a group of artists together, and invariably there will be conflict. Well, thank you. I think that concludes our presentation. I hope it's helpful and useful.
Thank you so much for you guys to join us, and all that experience and knowledge that you shared. We wanted to kind of have an opportunity to ask some follow-up questions.
This is my cat, Puffers.
Oh,
with a Z. She's a Siamese. She also is part of the Q&A.
Nice. So you guys, at the beginning, you brought up how important we as artists need to push funders for system change. And I think this is something that we've heard in the community that are in many ways like trying to not just get their foot in the door with even just getting funds, but also trying to explain some of the different cultural practices that they do that, you know, in many Canadian kind of society is not even recognized, right? And so I'm wondering if you guys can share or expand on like these tangible ways that we could be pushing these funders.
I think there's like a few ways. Obviously, you know, if you want to directly call the funder and have them and set up a meeting to offer them
feedback,
which we definitely have done. But I think there's another way for just in terms of accessibility, you know, there's other ways that you can share resources. And also like feedback is with other artists, is talking about and talking through with other artists, comparing your experience, comparing notes. And Dave and I are both in different kind of art circles where there's so much overlap in bad experiences with a particular art gallery or a particular film festival, et cetera, et cetera. And word travels fast. And I think it's especially important to talk to each other. And I think, I think if you're a new up and coming artist, you're an emerging artist, you may not know that you can do that because you don't know who to trust, which is why I just can't keep honing this point enough, which is relationships. You know, when you have social trust with people, then you can access different types of resources and tools, right? You know who to trust so that you can talk to this person about a bad experience that you had with a funder. No, and you know that you're not going to get any backlash from having those types of conversations.
Yeah, an example that comes to mind, and I still encounter it, so I'm not going to say that this is a successful pushback because it hasn't actualized yet, but one of the things, Jen and I, in the work that we do, always share ownership and directorialship with our participants. It's an ethical responsibility, but it's also a way that we build trust with our participants so that we, to the point where we give our documentary participants veto power. So they can actually, if we're done the project, we're about to release it, and they say, I don't want my story out, we give them veto power. So, but funders hate that because they want to know who owns this. Even when I'm applying for a travel grant, which is not a lot of money, they're like, well, who owns it? And I'm like, well, I don't own someone else's story, right? Mm-hmm. And it's something that I constantly have to have conversation with funders about, because there is this, I mean, I get upset for a moment, but there's a very like colonial and extractive capitalist mentality in the arts of like, you know, this artist that, you know, comes up with this genius idea that is their idea that they own, you know, and that's really problematic. And I'll just speak specifically to our work again of sharing someone else's story, you know, which is most of the work that we do. It's really important that we interrogate that it's not Jen and my, I'm literally editing someone else's words in the edit suite. So how do we do that in a good way? So that, and part of that is making sure that Jen and I don't own that, you know, someone else's story.
Mm-hmm. And I think we all play the game, right? Like in order to access funding, we adapt and cater our language to the grant funder's language. So there is a kind of dance that that we have to do with funders, you know? And that's just part of the game that we have to play. But there are other ways to circumvent and to mitigate some of the like, you know, like paying artists well. We follow Carfax, but we like to pay more than Carfax, right? So those types of things, because unfortunately in capitalism, we that translates into money. So we have to pay people well.
Yeah, just, and I'll just underline, you know, CARFAC, it's a minimum recommendation.
Yes, that's you can go above CARFAC, and as you should.
Yeah.
Gosh.
It sounds like the persistence is definitely a huge part of what I'm hearing. Obviously, the theme of relationality is just super key. You know, not staying silent, and that there is ways that through your kind of community there's ways to eventually see kind of system change. So yeah, I really appreciate you know, sharing those kind of experiences, because I think a lot of artists, they do feel isolated wherever they are. And so, you know, especially now with the, you know, just how prevalent digital technology is, and even having a space like CanAsian Arts Network and these connections that are built there, you know, hopefully people like really don't feel as if they're kind of alone in kind of tackling some of the different issues that do come up systemically. So yeah, thank you so much for sharing that. I'm curious with, you know, you guys talked a bit about hot pot talks and how, you know, a lot of even those kind of discussions have, given way for channeling and maybe opening up and creating more nuance around anti-racism in the work of so many different types of organizers. What do you think is like the direction in these kind of conversations, or have there been any like really cool things that have come about through these discussions that have created some impactful changes that you can see?
The one that comes to mind is kind of what we already alluded to in the last project, Elements Unite. I think this is, again, why I said, you know, I think artists are always five steps ahead of the funder, because the conversations around that I see anyways, when I look at a grant, a lot of the affirmative action representation conversations, artists have been having this for decades.
Yes.
And so, but the conversations, and this is not a new conversation, but this is, I'm hearing a lot around how do we build intercultural solidarity, particularly around, you know, racialized artists, too, recognizing that we have, you know, of course, anti-Black racism and anti-Indigenous racism obviously is a different experience than anti-Asian racism. But there is a conversation that I'm hearing, and we've had this on Hot Pot Talks, around the need for solidarity. And so that's been an exciting thing that has inspired Jen and I as we continue, yeah, specifically the project, for example, with Nadine and others.
So, you know, I guess it's so funny. I like some of the emojis that you guys had kind of like sprinkled in there, like some of the boring stuff that could come up with.
Come on, let's face it, we're artists.
We don't want
to be writing grants. I don't want to know how to do QuickBooks and do like that's just not, it doesn't come easy to us. And so we, you know, sorry to interrupt you, Sean, but you know, like we have to do so much.
Just because we're Asian doesn't mean we're good at math.
Well, I think it's a good reality check for a lot of kids that are trying and or thinking about being an artist full time, right? Or an artist that is centered around just the arts sector, right? You know, we shouldn't glamorize just like that really front-facing part where, you know, obviously a lot of beautiful relationships and art itself gets created, but behind the scenes there's so much administratively that we really should be preparing ourselves for.
I wanted to quickly mention, I learned this term recently, the funding treadmill, and that has just really stuck to us. And that's something that, thank you, Sean, for bringing that up, because that is something Jen and I as Jen mentioned, we don't have operational money. And the funding treadmill, as in applying for grants, patching grants so that you can continue the work, has often led to burnout because when you don't have operational money, you only have project money. So you have to create different projects to sustain your work.
Yeah.
It also means you have all of these deliverables for each project that you have to do for the funder.
Yeah. We're only just now starting to apply for a certain type of operational, but we're justifying it in a way where we talk about all these case studies, all these projects, all these relationships that we're a part of, because so much of our artwork that we produce is through a kind of community responsive, is a community response. And so when there is a crisis that happens or there's a global reckoning that is happening, we don't have operational funds to be able to respond now and make a project now and collaborate now. So, you know, like David said, we're constantly trying to catch our breath and trying to fundraise more money in order to be responsive to community needs.
Like, for example, like the Chinatown Cares, that's a perfect example. Like we should have made that 2 years before. Like, so we made the film in 2022. The Chinatown Cares initiative was started in 2020. I mean, what would have been useful to them, I think, for their fundraising was if we could have jumped and had the operational money to make that film so that they could use it for their fundraising so that it could serve the elders that they serve. But instead, you know, 2021 happened, then the funders are, oh, there's anti-Asian racism now. And then we apply for the funding and then we produce the film 2 years later. So it's this sort of, it's an annoying thing that we have to navigate often.
Yeah. And, you know, I definitely, like, there's a lot of tension, obviously, when we talk about administration and even this journey in administration, especially if you are a racialized or marginalized group, you know, starting from scratch and just having to almost make all the mistakes and finally, you know, get to something that is more sustainable, or hopefully something that's more sustainable. I kind of want to, you know, you guys to share, like, maybe what the light of the end of the tunnel might be. I mean, you talked about operational funding, right? And so is that something that it is a trajectory that you guys are going towards, you know, because it doesn't sound like where you guys are at is necessarily like where you're comfortable yet, right? And so it would be great to kind of also encourage folks to see that this is, you know, either a never ending journey and or something that is, like, you know, inherently like a systemic issue, or, you know, just
it's a really good question. Sorry, David, go ahead.
No, and I'll be honest with you. So Jen and I are at a crossroads right now, because there is, when you do get operational funding, and again, I'll give a caveat that funders have, you know, it's no longer necessarily like this, but also if you get operational, you're ineligible for some grants. So for example, Canada Council, if you get operational, you are ineligible for certain grants. And so when you get, and this has happened to Theatre for Living, where they had an operational, they had a reduction in their operational, but that also that means they couldn't apply for certain project funding. So where Jen and I are at a crossroads is also like and then when you get operational, the amount of administration quadruples, because you have to go through CADAC, which is a specific system that to account for the money. And so Jen and I are kind of at a crossroads where, you know, we know that in order to grow and to not be, you know, living, you know, or have all this precarity around our arts practice, we know that operational and getting bigger is necessary. But that also comes at a, you know, triple the admin, then you're raising money purely for staffing to support the money, and then you're just fundraising.
And we don't want to keep fundraising. That's not what our art is.
We joke that the dream is an endowment where we're just funded through the interest from this, you know, $1 million endowment. But, you know, what artists get an endowment, right?
I'm curious also now, you know, we've kind of talked a lot about so many different structures, you know, for folks that are just starting off, are there some materials or any kind of, you know, places where people could learn about this from the start that you guys have thought have been very helpful?
What comes to... Oh, go ahead, Jen.
I was going to make a joke about the internet. I think easily Googleable, but go ahead.
What I was going to say is going back to like starting with your networks, because we basically started with, we asked the nonprofits that we had relationships with to give us like templates. A lot of that information, in my experience, isn't necessarily like the bylaws and constitution stuff doesn't have to be confidential, you know? I mean, and in fact, I don't even know if it is. I think that there's likely, actually, I don't know the legalities around that, but I mean, for ours, for example, I mean, I'm happy to share our constitution and bylaws, because at least it's the work is already done. You'd have to change it to adapt to what you're doing, but that sort of stuff. And I think most nonprofits would be willing to share.
I think that's also something I think David and I are very intentional in modeling as we work with different types of people in different types of settings, who may or may not, you know, depending on, you know, the person's background or experience, who may or may not actually know that you can share resources. But so much of, you know, there's so much like isolation. It's weirdly there's the competitive nature of, you know, arts and competing for funding, I think is the cause of this, right? Where people are really protective of their lessons learned, their tools and their resources, their Excel spreadsheets and all of those things that they built. For us, we try to like, you know, push back against that. And one of the ways we do that is through the modeling, by just sharing as many resources as we can to anybody who asks for them.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I totally, I really echo that as well. I think that beyond the words, what you guys have shared is, that importance of relationship and how you're doing, like doing it in a good way. So as much as like it's very, you know, I would say potentially boring to have to like create all this paperwork, it is really important to ensure that what you're actually doing out in community or in your arts practice is matching what you have on paper, because quickly, if it's not, you know, you're not going to be able to really make sense of it all in many ways. So you could copy things that are out there in the public. Yeah. However, you know, even as, you know, as you're writing your grants and you're figuring out your budgets and just thinking about what is your kind of core to doing this work, mm-hmm. if those relationships aren't really there, or if there isn't really that like core matching between like the words and what you're doing, it'll quickly just not kind of be fruitful.
Yeah, it's also, you know, why I mentioned, you know, as I mentioned, when the funders are, you know, are behind, you know, it's also like thinking about those different structures, you know, like the idea of the nonprofit and the co-op is meant for like, you know, transparency and democratic values, but it's still, I think, kind of a bare minimum. And when we think about how do we enact those things, it's why I mentioned that, you know, with Value Co-op, we transferred the decision-making to the workers, is because even though it's set up, the co-op is set up to be the most democratic for-profit entity, it's only doing so much. And we could do, you know, so much more with how we build the organization.
All right. Well, is there any kind of last things that you'd like to leave for viewers as we kind of close up?
Don't be daunted by all these scary, because I remember when I first started, like starting a nonprofit, starting all these entities seemed very daunting and scary. Don't be scared by it. It's not as daunting as it is. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Jen and David, joining us today. We're grateful to have the support of Canada Council for the Arts and Festival Access AZ to making this CanAsian Arts Network project possible. If you are an Asian Canadian artist looking for more support, visibility, and community connection, we'd love to invite you to join the free network at www.canasianarts.com. and follow us on our social media platforms. We hope this workshop has been helpful for your artistic journey, and for more in-depth discussion about business issues for artists, log into CanAsian Arts Network to access our online groups and go to business administration and legal considerations. See you online. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.